Alright, so then today, well, this is more of an update of this worksheet that I've made for this, the EcoVillages. Now, I added in a whole bunch of mathematics before, and then I went back and I edited it, and I updated it, and made it a little more clear, and I believe I caught a few errors, but yeah, so we're dealing with the amenities. Because each house, you know, it's in a, let's say you have the cob house, Amenity Deluxe, or you have the tepee, Amenity Luxurious. All of those are amenity changes. So I want those to be easily swapped, whether it's a tepee or a cob house, actually. I want that same price. I know that seems ludicrous at first, but I believe the whole process of this particular EcoVillage that I'm trying to create, it's not about a limitation on that particular house being worth so much value. It's the adventure of it, and so that you can go from the teepee, and then you can get one of those cob houses. You can swap the houses. So I'm really into having the teepee people, who also pay $5,000, that's just like a real normal minimum, to be able to swap houses with the people who have the cob houses. Now they're little tiny houses, so they're not big, but yeah. So and so I added the amenities. What else did I add into it? There's owner increases. Now, owner increases are like, let's say, you know, you moved into your little cob house and you upgrade it and you upgrade it and you upgrade it, and you're like, well, I've upgraded it. So, I included those types of increases into the mathematical formula. So, when you go to sell it, it has a set price. Based upon your increases. Now, if you want to swap it, you'll be like, "What? Oh, that's impossible now. It's impossible to do the mathematics." But not if it's another person who's increased their house, whether it's a teepee or a cob or a straw bale, to the same amenity amount. So, the same owner increase amount. So if they've gone in and they've upped their increases to a level 3 as an owner, and over there that teepee, they up theirs to a level 3, then you can easily swap that house without any additional money being spent. You don't have to spend any money. That's the whole point of it. Okay, it's very easy to exchange them. Now, but money does have to be spent if you're going to go to an owner increase house. So let's say somebody puts $5,000 extra into their house. It's the same amenity level. It's a deluxe or something. Okay, you both have deluxe, and yet they decided to go an extra $5,000. Well, somebody there, the new buyer has to pay the $5,000, obviously. Now, and that $5,000, the proceeds of that, an amount goes to the cooperative itself, the large cooperative that is the money handler, which I essentially goes to the bank account first for the corporation, and then it gets divvied out to the builders. Now the builders get a share because they participated, and the owner gets a share. Okay. In most cases, the owner is the builder also, so he gets a builder share. And then if he did make these amenities, like let's say $5,000 more, that would be included in the breakdown. I really hope I did the math on that right. Gosh, it was a tough equation. But yeah, I'll go back and look. Did I do it right? Yes, I think so. The amenities based upon the co-op, anyway, you can look at it. I really think I got it correct. Yeah, because there was a swap value. I made a determinable swap value, so the house was $50,000, and then the other one was $55,000, so there was a determinable swap value of $5,000. And so that would be the only amount of money that is actually changing hands to this one who just upped his house. Okay, so that owner who upped a house and is selling it wants that $5,000. He doesn't get $5,000, he gets some of that money paid to the builders, he gets some of that money paid to the co-op, and yeah. So yeah, it is the amenity increase. Okay, so let's stop it. Okay, yeah, I did fix it. Okay, I'm sorry, that was just a bunch of math. Yeah, okay, so I don't think I'm singing today. But anyway, it's fun to sing. I'm getting back into it. Yikes, I'm getting my words through my brain. And I'm going through the memorizations of, you know, as many songs as possible, and it's quite fun, learning tactic. It's very important. It's very important to know the words. And after all these years, I actually didn't really know the words, you know, verbatim. And it's like a jump off the cliff, you know, and you're like, uh-oh. You know, I can't even look at the words anymore because they really are a crutch. They really are a crutch. And I've been overdone looking at them. A few of them I have in my head already, and I don't even know how. Those are the weird songs. When you have them in your head, and you can't even, like, write them down, you can't even go slowly with them. They just, when the music happens, the words appear in your brain. I don't know how that occurs. It's pretty weirdo. But yeah, those are the ones that are almost scary because they're like stuck in my brain somewhere in a little tiny place that doesn't want to even be listed anywhere else, only when the music plays. But I'm supposed to be talking about my new sheet. Okay, now the EcoVillage sheet, it goes to... I included a qualification list. Now, so that's for new people, for anybody who wants to join. So that would be a list of what they're looking for, anything strange or unusual about them that we need to know, because all of that will help. You know, do we put all of the ex-prisoners together? Do we put all of the people who have bad credit together? I really don't like that situation, but we do have terrible situations with, I guess they're called like bounty hunters here in America, and I was at their absolute chokehold for a while, for no reason, when I was thieved. So because I was at their chokehold, I know how they are, and I don't want to live in a village with those people attacking, because they really are attackers. I don't want to live anywhere where they are after anyone. So that's something that we really need clarity on. We cannot be going into, if you're in a credit debt village, Eco Village, I don't want to be there. You know, they're too aggressive. Okay, so next, finally, that they've sorted it out, and it's all my, apparently my record is clean, and it was like it never happened. I was only just harassed for years. But you know, so what in light is that? That they were allowed to harass me for years, and give me all kinds of duress. How is that fair? I'm just, you know, it's just terrible. It's a terrible situation. Okay, so I wrote things down on the qualification list. Yeah, so you know, like if you have children, you only want to be around people who have children. You only want houses of couples with people with children in them. So you can have like a, make a school or something. That's okay. You can group all of you together, you know. If you want only singles, you can group all of you together. If you want only couples without children, group you together. So, because apparently there's a rift. There's just a rift because there's a lot of weirdos, and I understand the rift, oddly. And then what was the other one? Where children are just allowed. So if you're in like a neighborhood and somebody has their kid over there, then it's okay. So yeah, so I made those different qualifications, but that would be more mixed neighborhood where you have singles or couples. That would be more of a normal scenario. Not just only children in every house. That was an unusual one only, you know. So I added that one. I made a huge list, which is kind of fun, of all the specialties. You know, if you're a tribe, you want to call yourself an eco tribe, your village. If you're a wool worker and all of that. So it details that. So it's good for the office, you know, so whenever ever anybody new, a new member is joining, we have an easy inclusion there. Who do you want to be with? You know, what are you looking for? It'll be easier to match up. You know, when we have 5,000 people, 5,000 houses here pending to be built, we have got to, you know, have a really good sound database, and I believe I did that. I believe I simplified it, so anybody who runs databases should be able to understand it pretty simple to fill it out even, and we can have a lot of people. I don't know, what was I talking about? Anyway, yeah, that's database people. You can make your own, and you know, do the math in different. I don't like her math, and then we can check. But it is kind of a complicated equation. It's a complicated equation because I want that amenity structure to be the you know, you have your basic, your standard, your deluxe, or your luxurious versions of a house, and that's it. And they're going to be all small houses. They're not going to be big Wawa land houses. If you wanted to do that, if you wanted to go and buy one and then build on it, that's your option. But you're going to have a difficulty finding somebody within the villages who wants to purchase it. You'll probably have to go with an outsider. And so that would be your only drawback. Okay. And the cool thing about all of this is the builders get paid. I determined the first time only, like when the house is sold to an outsider, the builders get paid. Okay, if it's exchanged with an amenity swap, an increase owner increase swap, they get paid then also. So the builders get paid all kinds of times. So if the house swaps 5 or 7 or 20 times, you could be, as a builder, you could get paid again and again and again and again. But once it gets sold to an outsider, I'm not kidding, then you only get paid that one time. So oddly enough, with swapping and exchanging the houses, you get paid more often. Smaller amounts, but you can get paid more often. So yeah. So that's kind of the system of it. Now, and I was also looking at, obviously, the larger property, you're looking at, you know, 2,000 acres, you're looking at, that's hard to find. It's very difficult to find. So I believe I saw one the other day, 1,600 in Colorado. You can find chunks of land that large, you know, for the whole project, and that would be wonderful. But it's going to be difficult. Near California, big city, San Francisco, very difficult. We'll probably have to ask the state. The state might have some BLM land that maybe they are tired of, and they will want to release it to us. But yeah, I don't know, with a large property, that is cool and all, but chances are it's not going to be easy to find. Yeah, because that would make things easier. We'd have fewer roads. We could have like only like two or three main roads off of the thoroughfares into the villages, into the village system, and then maybe connector villages. You know, once you're in there, you know, so that makes it kind of less road costly. Now, I did include the chance of if there, because so many wells will be dug or bored, those are costly. They can be very much expensive to drill a well. So if there was a way to somehow get like a cheaper version, I know I saw them in Mother Earth News. They're like, I don't know, 5,000 ones. $5,000 for like a mini well driller. So those ones, maybe they work, maybe they don't work, I don't know. But those are to consider. Alternatively, only have three or four or five wells dug over a large property area that has a lot of eco-villages in it with the different types of communities. And if you go that way, then you would have a water truck from those certain bored wells deliver water. So you could get away with three to five wells and then have them keep refurbishing water to the other eco-villages within our cooperative. Okay. So, I don't know. So that's... Oh, and also, okay, back to the water itself, during bathing, during the whole process, because these are builders that really, you know, we're looking at teepees, we're just in tents, or cars even. Now, in these situations, how are you going to bathe? I was looking at the community pool, having some kind of a large community pool that recirculates the water. We keep that water recirculating, and while it's recirculating and being filtered with that recirculation process, it's also heated, so we can have some kind of a Fresnel system. I did make it in my mind just with a simple sandbag or a rock where you can turn guide the Fresnel, the large Fresnel plate, about a $100 version. I believe they're quite expensive. But you turn that plate, not by yourself, it would be a sun tracker. So you use the sun tracker version where you have it wrapped around a rope, simple rope wrapped around a table. And the table is in a T formation. It's in a T formation like a tack, an attack that goes into a hole. So the tack goes into a hole and it twirls, okay? Now it twirls based upon the rope. So you have the rope tied all the way around that table. Now, the rope is just simply connected. Here's the thing. The rope is simply connected to, over here, a rock on, and what happens is over time, the rock drops and the thing untwists, okay? And as it untwists, the table is here on top. As it untwists, the sun tracker that's on top, here's the sun tracker, Andrea, sun tracker's on top, turns around and around and around. And it's because it turns around and around and around, you end up with many days possible where you don't even have to attend to it. Many days where that Fresnel is pointing at the sun, and then it's not pointing at the sun because it's nighttime. And it's pointing at the sun again, and then it's nighttime. So you could probably do it, you know, a week or even more. You know, if you get that sand proportion on the twisted tack table, I'll call it a twister tack table. As it unwinds, this lowers, lowers, and lowers, and lowers. Okay, So I think you got understand what I'm saying. When I say lower, this is on some kind of a ladder, or it's just you know, it drops slowly. And as it drops, this unwinds. Okay, so that was really my cool design for the day. I haven't been doing those for a while. Yeah, I that one got me for a time. I wrote it down on I did make a sun tracker, but it was getting so confusing, that page, that I couldn't update it any longer. I made a page so confusing I couldn't even go into it. I'm sure you all know that. So where are we next? Did I miss anything? Probably. I probably did. But yeah, I think the sheet is getting better. And so now that I also put in the equation, the simple, very basic mathematical equation for the house has already been sold to an outsider that was a new member, and they paid full price, $50,000. And another new member comes along and wants it. So that there's no builder in that point. The builders aren't paid any longer because the original first member, he already dealt with paying the builders out. Okay, so it's the second time it's sold to an outsider. Okay, and that outsider becomes a new member. Okay, if that makes any sense. But yeah, but that's. You know, because eventually, oh my gosh, sell, but this one is this person, and that one's that, it solves it. Okay, so I've solved all of those weirdo problems, hopefully. And there is the part you can put in any amount different if you didn't like the numbers that were already present and available. Okay, and yeah, I don't know, I love the idea of making them all teepees and just making a huge, massive teepee village. But not just one village. I don't think it's going to work, one village. I think it has to be a whole bunch of separate villages that do different things. Like, they're the woolworks people. And over there, they're the ones that make gourmet foods, ooh-wah. And they are, you know, 50 strong. And over there, there's 50 people strong, and or 50 houses strong, and another 50 houses strong. And then maybe they have another population of 100 over there, strong, but 50 houses. And all of, and they make what? What do they do? I don't know. Mixed variety of vegetables. And all of them meeting up at market time. It just sounds so easy, doesn't it? To make our own world in a way. And some of those are just religious groups. And some of them over there are only gay. And some of them over there, oh my gosh, just single women who just don't want anything to do with men. So you're going to have all of these different types of communities be able to happen. Now, I know you were like, oh, mixed everything. Well, mixed everything hasn't worked. Mixed everything has just not worked. People are out there in the streets and they kill each other. I don't like mixed everything. I don't like mixed neighborhoods. So I guess I'm a segregationist. You can call me that. Just not ethnic, just not racist, but I am segregating these groups because I think people are more content with your kind. You look at the people who are the rich; they only want to swig drinks with the rich. You know what I'm saying? That's the way it goes. Like the way it goes in all levels of society. No matter, you know, teachers want to be around other teachers. You know, they often even marry them. So all of these things, think about. Okay, I did add bamboo to the sheet also as being a very important to a growing bamboo. I've used bamboo in the past. It's an amazing, amazing plant. It's always there. You put it near a water source. You have an instant framing construction. A material for greenhouses, for many things. So it's an absolute keep material that we have to grow in every eco village. Okay. I think that's all I can think about right now. garden tools shared. That was it. Yeah, the sharing of all garden tools. And there's a lot of things that will be shared. Certain EcoVillages, I know you already, you are going to share even your cell phones. You are even going to share the numbers of your bank accounts. Certain EcoVillages are going to be that tight, because that's just the way you are. Because maybe you have no money. So there's a joke anyway. So if we all have one Go phone, you know, we can share that cost through 50 people throughout the entire year, and it will only be one Go phone cost. Okay, we won't be getting phone calls from people, but it will be maybe used. We might use it for our banking. Okay. So I'm looking at the use of one Go phone. I guess that's an AT&T product. Being used among 50 people, okay? What else? Yeah, a lot of those types of things. Shared everything. Now, when it gets to weeds and getting into the garden, I know the tactic of laying plastic down over. I'm against it. You can lay other things. You can lay material. So we can always, you know, sew up some cheap material, as long as it's dark enough and heavy enough, and lay that down over. I just don't like any chance of the leaching going into the wheat, into the soils from plastic. We already have so much in the rains already, so we don't need it also additional heavy on our vegetables. So yeah, I believe we can lay some kind of large blankets down and with rocks, and that will stop the weeds on certain things over winter time. Okay, what else? Oh my gosh, I know it. I really miss bamboo, actually. Bamboo is wonderful. I just love it. It's the greatest plant, I think so. Now, they make a whole bunch of different ones, but gosh dang it, yeah, it has to be at least a real good tall one. A real good tall one that goes maybe at over 12 feet. And we can use them also as privacy walls as well. Okay, all right, that's enough.